and welcome back to another episode of the On the Sideline podcast with Jackson and Kyle. I butchered the intro a little, but we're getting through it. I am joined here, as always, by the guy who makes up one half of the biggest Bengals hater podcast in the business. Kyle, how are you doing?
I'm doing good. I hate to be lumped into this because I haven't said anything bad about the Bengals this season. But, you know, it's okay.
I don't think either one of us have said anything bad about the Bengals. I think that we just haven't said maybe enough positives for the Bengals fans' liking.
Apparently because they're not Super Bowl contenders in our eyes, it's not good enough.
Yes, I think that's most of it. We'll get more into that when we talk about the actual Bengals game itself. Bengals are good, but let's not start there. We have a game to recap, the Monday night game, the marquee matchup, the Saints Seahawks. We can just start here, I think. A competitive game, at least.
Yeah, competitive. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was like what? So there was the 84-yard touchdown for the Seahawks on their second drive of the game, and then they had 139 yards the rest of the game.
Right.
Alvin Kamara basically got the ball every touch for the New Orleans Saints. And that was basically the game. Get the ball to Kamara, control the clock, and then Seattle's offense just has no chance, right?
Yeah, I mean, although the flip side is, like, Seattle had this game won. I mean, if they make their field goals, I mean, this is a Seahawks, potentially a Seahawks win. So, you know, they would have wanted to score, but obviously things change if that happens, like strategy-wise and everything. But I mean, you know, Seattle had a very real chance to win this game. To me, the more interesting question is, because I think the Seahawks are done without Geno Smith. I just don't think they're a good team. I think, should we be concerned at all with the Saints team struggling against the Seahawks? Or is this, hey, it's one of those games, at least you got the one?
I mean, that was kind of my thought is, like, I just don't think either of these teams are very good. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, like I don't think the Saints are very good, but I think there's a lot of bad teams they're in front of, too. Like, I think that's kind of been the theme of this season is that there's kind of a lot of bad football teams right now. And I think the Saints are kind of benefiting from there being a lot of bad teams behind them. Because, despite all this, you know, I still rate them over the other two NFC South teams not named the Bucks, you know. And I still rate them probably above a handful of teams in the NFC. So they might still get a wild card by default. I just don't know if there's seven good teams in the NFC right now.
Yeah, and listen, I mean, it's not the worst strategy in the world to say, like, hey, we're going to rely on our defense and Alvin Kamara. Like, that's a winnable strategy. You'll win some games. Now, how many games? We win enough to, you know, make the playoffs or go on a deep run. I don't know, but there's at least some, like, real value there. And I think Winston's playing fine. I don't think Winston's, like, I know his interception numbers are down, so everyone's kind of, there's almost been like this. Winston's just the weirdest thing where there's just always going to be people who undyingly think that he's garbage and undyingly think that he is the best quarterback ever. It's just the most baffling thing to me.
He's, there's a few guys in the NBA like that I can make comparisons to, but I think they're actually a little better than Winston. So it's probably an unfair, like, it's like, you're either pro Rudy Gobert or anti Rudy Gobert, and there's no in between. And it's basically like however you feel about his game. Although I think, like I said, Rudy is a better version of an NFL player than Jameis is of NFL player. But, you know, I think he's fine. And I think the good thing that he's done is he hasn't, I mean, there's still been the highlights. There's still been, or the low lights for Jameis, you know, there's still been those moments where you're like, what the hell are you doing? But at the same time, I think we're seeing that less and less in New Orleans. And I think they kind of know, hey, you know, we're going to let you take a shot here or there. You're going to take one or two shots a game, basically. But this is an offense built around Kamara. This is an offense built around using your tight ends effectively. This is just, you know, you're going to play our football, and then we'll let you sling it a couple times.
Yeah, it's interesting. Saints are still one of those teams tough to get your finger on exactly. Interesting matchup against Tampa Bay. We will preview that. I think we can move on from this game, right?
Yeah, I mean, I can continue to come back to this, like, because I was low on the Seahawks to start the year. It just, I didn't want to see this happen. I didn't want to see Wilson go down. And it's just kind of like, this kind of just a lost year for them. I don't think this team's going to win a lot of games.
Yeah, seems unlikely. All right, so here we go. Back to the main topic of what this show will be about. We are picking, of course, every single game this week. It's so the way this works, if you have not watched before, is Kyle's going to give me a game. I pick who wins. Then I do the same for Kyle. You get a point for getting the game incorrectly, so you don't want points. We also have a lock of the week, which is sort of a double or nothing thing. You get it wrong, you get 2 points, but you get it right, 2 points come off your score. So, Kyle, you closed, you know, you led most of the season. I had a big week, that would have been week six, but then you closed the gap a little bit. We've had a competitive game so far. I am up 19 to 22.
Yeah, good start to this season. Slow. I had a bad week, and I'm trying to make up ground now to make up for it. So just one little step at a time, chipping away at the lead. I think I got a good week here ahead of me.
Okay, well, this is a tough one. I mean, this is a difficult – I think there's a lot of – you know, last – we've had a couple of clunkers. There's a lot of interesting ones in this mix here. So let's just get into it. Why don't you give me a game?
All right, I'm going to go with nobody's marquee game of the week, but I do think it's a competitive game. And we had a lot of talk about this on Sunday night, too, so I think it's interesting. Divisional matchup, Panthers at Falcons is my first game of the week.
Yeah, this is an interesting one. This is one I think no one really wants to pick. I think both of these teams are teams that are still holding on to potential like playoff aspirations. I mean, you ask their fan bases, they're going to feel good about it. I think one of the interesting things about Atlanta is Matt Ryan's quietly actually played really well after like week two. And so it's like we all kind of said, like, okay, Matt Ryan sucks, whatever, is what it is. And then he's actually like played pretty decent. So that's the value there. Meanwhile, of course, Sam Darnold's had the opposite, where after a couple of weeks, he's just fallen off a cliff. This is a good pick because these are two teams I do not have a handle on. This feels like a coin flip game. I'm going to go with the home team here, the favorites. I'm going to pick the Atlanta Falcons here, Kyle.
I think it's a good pick. I think that this offense can make some plays. They still have kind of crazy to say. I think Atlanta has better playmakers. You know, I haven't been impressed with the way the Panthers receivers have played the last couple weeks. They're not the same team without McCaffrey. I like Ridley. I like Pitts. I like Cordarrelle Patterson. I think that's a better group than whatever the Panthers can put on offense. Now, granted, I think the Panthers defense is much better than the Falcons defense. But does Carolina without McCaffrey have the pieces to attack this defense? I'm not sure if they do. Now, we could see some bad Matt Ryan plays or just, you know, bad plays in general that this Panthers defense takes advantage of. But I'm willing to say the Falcons just with the better playmakers win this game.
Yeah, I think that's a fair bet. And one of the interesting things about Carolina as well is they haven't been able to get these guys, scheme these guys open the way they have in the past. And even Darnold, like, you know, there's been just some weird decision-making he's made where guys have been open and he just, like, isn't throwing them the ball. So it's just kind of a weird situation with Carolina. And I think there is some real potential. Like, again, I'm not saying Carolina can't win. This feels like this could go either way. Is this one of those games where the loser is just done?
If you think these two still have a chance.
Okay, I mean, so you think they're done already?
I don't know. Like, I don't see, like, if Atlanta wins this and goes 4-3, like, that's great. But does this look like a playoff team? Like, I don't know. Like, maybe coincidentally they kind of fall into it. But at the same time, like, you just start looking at the wild card teams. You know, you're going to have potentially the Los Angeles Rams as a wild card team. You're going to have you know, right now it would be the Los Angeles Rams. It would be, who would be after that?
It would be the Saints actually at 4-2. And that's the thing, is that third wild card spot is currently, like, the Falcons are, I believe it's the Falcons here. They're looking at the Falcons and Vikings are tied for that 7 seed. So yeah, they're in the hunt. I mean, you know, you could say that, like, it's because there's a lack of a 7th good team in the NFC, but still.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Like, I think the Vikings are a way better team, but at the same time, the Vikings haven't really, like, won games they should have won, and that's been a big problem with the season because they have a really difficult schedule, so maybe they end up falling into it, but I don't think this is a, like, I'm not convinced either of these teams are going to damage, but I guess, yeah, you kind of have to say they might still be a playoff team with the 49ers and the Seahawks kind of falling apart.
Yeah, and you know, you play the Saints a couple times, like, they're a team, like, you know, if you can win those, you know, they do have a bit of an easier schedule. So it's certainly possible. Again, and it goes same way for Carolina. They're only a half game back of Atlanta. So it goes both ways. Both these teams have a chance. And, you know, I think for Carolina, too, it's like, hey, just stay afloat until McCaffrey gets back. It's almost like one of these teams that loses their quarterback. And it's like, oh, you just got to stay afloat. It's kind of like that, but with their running back for them.
Isn't it crazy how impactful he is for this team? Like, this offense has not been the same since he was gone. Not even close.
Yeah, and I think a bit of it, too, has just been who they played weeks 1 through 3. That also factored in.
That's fair.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, let's move on. Let's go to – I'm going to give you a game I'm very interested in, a game I don't want to pick, and one that you probably don't want to pick either since it's your team. I'm giving you Patriots at Chargers here. Where are you going?
I'm interested in this game because the argument, of course, is does Brandon Staley continue to double down on this defensive system, which is good for a lot of teams. Like if you're playing the Chiefs, this is a good defensive system to have because the two deep safeties, they want to throw the ball. They want to throw the ball downfield. The Patriots do not want to throw the ball downfield. You know, this is a team that does short to intermediate passing. This is a team that runs the ball a lot. And the Chargers, because of this defensive scheme that ran, that was the best in the league last year, doesn't have Aaron Donald anymore, has been the worst rushing defense in football. Are they really going to do that with the Patriots, with the way they've run the ball this season, with the way Damian Harris has played the last couple weeks? Are they really going to do that? And as we've talked about before, this Justin Herbert, can he match with these man-to-man blitz schemes that have kind of gotten to him in the past, especially last year where I heard a podcast the other day say that the Chargers last season when that 45-0 lost was the worst football performance they've ever seen by a team. The matchup kind of lends itself to the Patriots, but the Chargers do have more talent. I'm going to go Homer. I'm just going to take the Patriots. I think they upset in this one. I think the Patriots have the good matchup. Mac Jones has played really good football the last couple weeks. I've really been impressed with him throughout this season. I think that they're gonna win this game. I don't think Brandon Staley is the type of guy to change from what he does best. I think he's just gonna, you know, keep to his defense, and I think we're gonna be able to run the ball.
Hey, you know, Patriots are underdogs here. You could lock them up. Don't have to cover any points.
I'm not going to lock it up.
Okay.
I know you're trying to goad me into it, but I do think that they can win this game, so I'm going to pick them.
No, listen, I mean, I gave you this game hoping you'd pick the Chargers, and I could, because I think the Patriots should be favorites in this one, even though they're 5.5-point underdogs. I'm with you. I think that this is a matchup thing. It's not a talent thing, but I think the Patriots are underrated. I think the Patriots are good. I think that there's a little bit more they could be doing. You know, we've talked about the downfield passing attack with Jones, but you don't need to do that this game. Run the ball, do the underneath stuff. They kind of work perfectly in that. And if, like you said, the flip side is Herbert has not looked good against this type of scheme, most notably last year, but even this year, like that's part of what shut him down for the Ravens. I think this is it's a bad matchup for the Chargers. And the nice thing about the Chargers is, you know, you're coming off a bye, you have time to prepare. And that's kind of what the hope is, that you can change some stuff up. But, you know, teams don't really do that as often as they probably should. So I'm giving this one to New England as well.
Yeah, I think so. And I think the way for the Chargers, Keenan Allen has to win the one-on-one matchup with J.C. Jackson, right? Like, that's basically what they have to do. Or the other part of this could be Austin Eckler just torches them. But, you know, I don't know if either of those two things are going to happen in this game. I haven't been overly impressed. I know the numbers aren't there, but even then, I just haven't overly been impressed with Keenan Allen this season. I think he's been all right, but they've used Mike Williams a lot for a reason. So I think it just lends to a matchup that the Patriots can take advantage of. And I like Bill Belichick to kind of, you know, do what he did last season and kind of dominate this game that way.
Yeah. All right. So interesting stuff. Picking an underdog with the second pick here. All right. Now you time for you to give me a game.
I'm going to give you this game because I don't want to pick either of these two teams to ever win a football game again. okay. I'm going balls at Broncos for you.
Yeah, this is another one. It's weird because this one was like fifth on my list, but I also I agree with you. Or actually, it's a sixth on my list, and I'm still like, yeah, I don't want to pick this one. There's a lot of games that are tough this week, a lot of games I don't want to pick. I'm going Denver here. At the time, I had logic for it. I'm trying to remember exactly what that logic was now. But I think that the Denver Broncos, I don't know. Both these teams suck. You're right. Like, who do you want to pick? I do feel like there is some talent here for Denver that, you know, but they've just completely fallen apart for these past few weeks. These are two weird teams. I don't like Washington either. This is a tough one, Kyle.
Yeah, I mean, I would probably pick Denver too, just being at home. And I mean, I've really just come to the point where I think Washington's one of the like six worst teams in football right now. Like, I think it's that bad. Like, I think I said it last Sunday. I know luck's involved with winning football games, but at the same time, this is two weird plays away from being like a winless team. I think they're that bad. So I think that I would probably pick Denver too, even though I'm not convinced with them at all. I just don't know if Washington's going to consistently throw the ball downfield enough on this team.
Yeah. And well, that's the other thing too. It's like, I just trust that Denver can get stuff going against the Washington secondary. And like, Bridgewater has proven he can be a good quarterback when there's a good situation around him. And I think there will be a good situation around him, largely due to the other team, especially in this one. So that's kind of a big part that I think factors in.
Yeah. So I would agree with you. So it'll be a close game though. Like I said, there's just a stink on both of these teams. It's like, I don't want anything to do with this game. I do think if you bet on this game, you actually have a gambling problem. So seek help.
Or maybe that's the fun of it, is to bet on the absolute worst games that are imaginable.
I guess so. I don't know.
Maybe you have a football problem because you're gonna watch this game and then you're
just screaming at whatever team you bet for, you know.
right. So again, should be interesting. I mentioned it, it should be interesting. I do think that there is at least part of it too, is I think Washington, like, what are you playing for at this point? At least for Denver, it's like, okay, you still probably have hope.
You do have hope, but you have to definitely win this game. If they lose, this is definitely like, if Denver loses, it's over, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably over already, but especially if they lose this one. Again, we don't spend forever on this. We can move on to another one if you want to. I'll give you a game. How does that sound?
Let's go for it.
Okay, I'm going to give you another couple of teams that are just kind of hard to get your finger on at this point. I'm going to give you 49ers at Bears. Niners are 3.5-point favorites. Where are you going?
I was stuck on this one too, man.
There's a lot of them. There really is.
Yeah. I wrote 49ers in my notes, and I'm just going to write 49ers. I mean, I hate to harp on the guy because it's not all his fault. He's got bad coaching. He's got a bad team around him. And his one asset was Allen Robinson, who hasn't performed. But Justin Fields has been the worst starting quarterback in football this year. And it's going to get better. It's going to be better going forward. But he's been the worst starting quarterback in football this year. I mean, I just don't know how you could debate it at this point. And I just find it hard to pick him in any situation. I get the defense is good. I get he has game-breaking abilities that are going to change things. But I think overall, even though you could say there's optimism from the game against Detroit, which, you know, it's Detroit, you just have to look at it and said he's been bad this season. And there's a lot of factors to it that aren't all him, but it's not a good situation. And I feel like this is kind of must-win for San Francisco.
Yeah, it is. San Francisco 2-4. And, you know, I mean, the way they're at, you know, they had Super Bowl aspirations. I mean, we picked them as a fringe playoff team, and Niners fans were mad at me. Like, what are you doing? It's a fringe playoff. This should be a Super Bowl team. Well, now they're not looking like a playoff team, period. Looks like we were all wrong. And this is not a great situation. One interesting stat, though, to throw at you, Jimmy Garoppolo, passer rating when blitzed, 120.2. Passer rating when he isn't blitzed, 85. Chicago is a team that does not blitz. They hang back. They play their coverage. They get pressure with four, although I believe Cleo Mack might be out, so that could complicate things. But you do this, play coverage. Jimmy G struggles with that kind of stuff. The offense for San Francisco has been lacking, and that's kind of why I think the Bears could win this one. I'm actually picking Chicago to win for that reason, even though I agree the Bears' offense is horrible, and regardless of what you put the blame on, it's not good. Like, everything about it has been tough. So that's kind of the issue. But if you can, you know, I guess the one flip side is, hey, Khalil Herbert's looked awesome. Just run the ball, put up 14. That might be enough to win this game.
Yeah, I could see this kind of being an ugly game. But, you know, I kind of feel like that San Francisco, like, it's kind of one of those things, again, where I still kind of just trust their playmakers a little bit more. Deebo Samuels, you know, despite all the struggles with San Francisco's offense this season, he's been really good this year. I'm just waiting for them to use Brandon Ayuk effectively again. Like, I don't know what happened between last season and this season.
Mm-hmm.
But this guy was like an explosive play machine last year, and it seems like they want nothing to do with him. I wouldn't mind seeing him on the field making some plays. You know, there's a whole lot of aspects that I think San Francisco can be better at, and I think they need to win this game. So I think they're going to pull out all the tricks.
Okay, so you're picking San Francisco to win this. If Andy Dalton is playing, do you still pick San Francisco to win this?
Maybe not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's do that. I mean, again, we talk about the NFC and how kind of weak it is. The Bears are 3-4, so they're a half game out. Is there some logic in, hey, Matt Nagy, you get to the playoffs, you might save your job again. You could say I've been to the playoffs 3 out of 4 years, which is kind of a weird stat to think about. Is there some logic in going back? The conversation is out there. For the record, I say stick with Fields. I don't think you put the toothpaste back in the tube, but what do you think?
I mean, the problem is then, you know, going forward, what does that do for Fields' confidence? You know, your future, like, even if Nagy considers this, I think the problem is I don't think Chicago, like the front office and the, you know, the higher ups are going to allow this, because what is it? You know, he's the most important asset in Chicago right now. You know, are you going to let his confidence get shot by basically saying, yeah, you're not ready, so let's go back to the bench? I think that's a huge problem, and I don't think it's something that's going to happen.
Yeah, I think I agree. I definitely don't think it's going to happen. I just think it's an interesting topic of discussion. And I guess, I mean, you could go to flip side as well. I mean, there's the Trey Lance in San Francisco aspect of this as well, right? Where that's another thing. Jimmy Garoppolo has not played well. I think they give it a few more weeks for Jimmy, though, and if it starts to fall off, then you see what you have in Lance. Let him get some reps in.
Yeah, I probably agree. I think Jimmy G plays this game. I mean, is Lance healthy enough to play this game?
Oh, I don't even know that. So that's another factor. But yeah, just interesting parallels. All right, let's move on. Let's go to, so you give me a game here.
All right. I can't believe I'm doing this. Whoever thought we'd say this in week 8 of the NFL season? Jaguars at Seahawks.
Okay, yeah, really, no kidding. This would have been, I mean, we would have thought this would be the last game picked, 20-point spread, and we'd be still locking up the Seahawks. Obviously, Russell Wilson being hurt makes this a lot worse. This is another one of these, you know, many games that I struggled with and had to think about. I'm going to go Seattle here. Seattle is the favorites, 3.5-point favorites. You know what? Actually, no. I'm gonna take that back. I'm gonna go Jacksonville. Changing my opinion right here on live on the spot. Changing it in my notes. Here's what I just thought of: the Seahawks don't blitz. Trevor Lawrence, rookie quarterback. I've been paying a lot of attention to that stuff because I realized that, like, hey, paying attention to that stuff can actually help you get your picks right better. Seahawks don't blitz. Jaguars, rookie quarterbacks always perform a lot better when they're not blitzed than when they are blitzed. I think the Seattle scheme is a lot easier to go up against for a rookie quarterback than, like, as opposed to some of these other schemes. I'm going to give it to Jacksonville, taking it back. I say the Jaguars win.
I was struggling with this because I had Jacksonville written down. Mm-hmm. And then, I was like, are they really going to win 2 in a row? Like, am I really going to say that?
Uh-huh.
But then the more I think about it, like, I have seen more improvement. I have seen improvement from Jacksonville's offense, mainly Trevor Lawrence. I have seen improvement out of Trevor Lawrence week after week. And I think that's something that you want to see at a rookie quarterback. And now I think that this is a defense he can kind of torch. Now, I'm not saying he's going to go for like 404 touchdowns or anything like that, but I think he could have a pretty good game this week. And I mean, I don't know if there's any team in the league Geno Smith can have a good game against. You know, I feel like it's almost that simple. I feel like Trevor Lawrence could have a good game, and I don't know if Geno Smith can. Now, of course, I think that Tyler Lockett and DK Metcalf can get open almost any defense, and especially Jacksonville. So I think that this is a pretty tough game to call. So I guess here's my question. If the Seahawks lose this, is everyone on the hot seat?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, I think the parallels, the obvious parallels to me are the season when Aaron Rodgers got hurt and Mike McCarthy was on the hot seat. He ended up getting another year, but that next year they still didn't perform well, only won 6 games, and McCarthy was fired that following year. I think there's some real logic behind it, and I've always kind of said you kind of really get to see who the coach is when your starting quarterback is injured. Like, however good they are, you get to see it a lot better. And I think that we haven't seen a lot of great stuff from the Seahawks. I mean, you know, they're running the ball way more now, which I guess makes sense. Like, they love to run the ball anyway. So now that you don't have a great quarterback, I mean, they're basically running one-to-one. So a little bit more than one-to-one, actually. So they're going to run the ball a lot, which I don't know if it's that's the best strategy against Jacksonville. I think you want to, you know, like you said, use DK Metcalf, use Tyler Lockett, that kind of stuff. I just don't know if they will. And I think that the Jaguars weirdly might have a coaching advantage in this one, which is not something we thought we'd say either. So I think Jacksonville wins.
Yeah, and they also don't really have a running back who's very good. You know, I think Collins had the nice game, but you know, he's not Chris Carson. So
I mean
I don't really know where
Seattle, and he's not James Robinson either
mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, I think Jacksonville's gonna be able to move the ball in this game. I think it's gonna be really tough for Seattle to win.
Yeah. Is this the first time in On the Sideline history that someone has said a pick but then changed it and gone to the other pick?
I don't know.
I think you might have done it before.
I'm sure I have. Mm-hmm. I'm sure we have at some point, but
it's a rarity for sure. All right, I'm gonna give you a game. I'm gonna give you your guy, Eagles at Lions here. This is a true tank bowl here in week 8. Who do you have winning this one?
I can't pick Dan Campbell again. You know, I love you, Dan, but we can't do this. I'm picking the Eagles. I think that, you know, Jalen, this is a game where, you know, all the talk of is Jalen Hurts going to lose his job, it's going to be quieted in this game for at least a couple weeks because everyone looks good against Detroit's defense. I think he's going to have monster numbers in this game. He's going to throw for a lot of yards. He's going to run for a lot of yards because they don't use running backs. I think the Eagles do win this game because, I mean, even though I don't think he's great, I think Hurts is the best player on the field in this one.
So counterpoint. Lions, another team who do not blitz a lot. Eagles, we've talked about this. Great against the blitz, horrible when they don't blitz. The difference, though, is it's kind of the stoppable force meeting the movable object here of the Eagles. You know, can they move the ball against this just awful team, even if that team has a scheme that kind of works against the Eagles?
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, sure, they don't blitz, but at the same time, they don't have anybody who can cover. So,
right. I mean, they might as well be blitzing with the, you know, might as well have five guys in coverage.
Yeah. So I don't know if it'll matter this much this week. Now, of course, the point to that, though, is that if it looks bad for Hurts in this one, then you might as well put a fork in it that, you know, he's been figured out, right? Because if they don't blitz him and he continues to look bad throwing the football, you might as well just say, okay, this guy's not an NFL quarterback. Because, go ahead.
Yeah, I think so. Well, I actually think like the real thing is like, yeah, I kind of agree. It's like he has to show some signs of life against a scheme that he's not the best at, as long as like it's a bad team. That's what he has to do.
Yeah, and this is a bad team, and so it'll be interesting. And then on the flip side, you know, it's kind of the same thing for Detroit for me every week. It's like, is Swift and Hawkinson going to make enough plays for this team to win a football game? Now, I think they're both really good players, but I mean, you're trusting two guys to win you a football game, basically. And Goff, I think, is decent too. You know, I don't think he's as much of a scrub as it's been talked about. He had, you know, so I think it's like, can those three guys make enough plays? I don't really think so.
Yeah, that's the Lions, not a good football team, but the best thing is greatest NFL head coach in history of sports.
Future President Dan Campbell.
Again, every week, it's just fantastic. I won't go on any rants this week. We can just by the way, like what Dan Campbell did last week. Want to say that again? That was very fun. The extra do that stuff again. You'll win this game maybe.
Yeah, I mean, he might have the coaching advantage. So there's that.
Yeah, really. There you go. So I mean, I guess you know. Going up against Nick Sirianni, kind of a in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king.
Yeah, fair enough. We can move on. You want me to give you a game?
Last thing. Has there ever been a coach who 8 weeks into the season has been hated more than Nick Sirianni already? I mean, like, and he even had like a week one blowout. Usually that'll give you like 2 years, and like Eagles fans are done with Sirianni.
Yeah. I mean, Philly fans are naturally ruthless, but it's already hit a tipping point. I don't really know what to think of it.
I don't even think he's been that bad. Like, I don't think it's like totally deserved, but they're done with him.
And it's not a good roster. And I think the thing is that's so goofy is I almost think the blowout win to start the season was the worst thing for him because it put too high of expectations all of a sudden on this team. Like this, we went into the season thinking this is one of the five or six worst rosters. And then all of a sudden now everyone's mad that they stink. Like,
right. They're probably overperformed if anything. All right, let's move on. So you give me a game here.
I feel like you're burying this one because you're going to lock it up. I'll give it to you. Titans at Colts.
Okay, Titans at Colts. I'm not locking it up. Nope, not locking it up. I do have... So this is another one. It's a one-point spread. Falls all the way here to the seventh game pick. So, you know, very interesting stuff there. Yeah, I think this is an interesting game. I am going the Titans here. I feel confident that the Titans will win. There's another lock I like better. But I think that the interesting thing for me is just, you know, Ryan Tannehill has played well. This offense has played well. Derrick Henry, his numbers aren't fantastic, but the threat of Derrick Henry makes stuff work. To me, the biggest question for the Colts is just how are they going to cover this Titans receiving core and Ryan Tannehill? I know Julio hasn't done a ton yet, but we've seen him start to have flashes again. And A.J. Brown had a huge week. So to me, that's kind of what I keep looking at. I think the Colts could put up points, but again, Titans defense has been playing surprisingly well this season. So you add on both of those factors. I just don't know if the Colts can pull this one off.
Yeah, I think I agree. I don't, you know, this, I'm interested in watching this Tennessee defense again, because that it's weirdly become like had moments that it's looked decent. And I don't know if that Chiefs thing is going to be an anomaly. I mean, I think it's going to be an anomaly, but yeah, I mean, the defense has looked pretty good. The defensive line, I think, has looked a lot better this last couple weeks. And then all of a sudden, like, if this is something that they can rely on, how good can this team be? So, yeah, I mean, I think I'd take the Titans still. I still think they have the better playmakers. I think at points it's going to be kind of an ugly game where teams are, you know, they're both just kind of running the ball into the strength of the defense for both teams. But at the same time, I do think Tennessee is going to be able to throw the ball downfield.
Yeah, I think so as well. I mean, so what's the path to victory for Indianapolis?
I think the one thing about this Titans team, I think the defensive line has been better, but they're pass rush heavy. Mm-hmm. So do you throw, I think they should immediately start the game with some Jonathan Taylor screens, you know, get that defensive line off of Carson Wentz. Cause the last thing we want on Carson Wentz is a pressured Carson Wentz, know, cause that's where things kind of get crazy for him. I would immediately give, you know, Taylor a couple screen passes, let him try and game break plays that way. Maybe that gets the defensive line off you. You can hit Michael Pittman, you know, do the things you like to do. Michael Pittman, play action to Mo Alie-Cox, those sort of things. And all of a sudden this becomes a, you know, this offense is moving the ball, and that's how you score points. And, you know, I do think it kind of, you know, they're going to have to try and keep up with this team because it's not the same Colts defense as last year.
Yeah. Am I crazy in thinking that it might actually make sense for the Colts to try and let Derrick Henry beat them, which is kind of the opposite of what teams naturally do? But, you know, you play cover two, which they like to play a lot. You don't get beat over the top, and you kind of let Derrick Henry run the ball. You're going to limit possessions that way. So you might have a lower possession game. You're going to run the ball a lot, so you limit possessions. I think you go into this one as kind of an underdog feel, and you just hope that you can get a couple of stops.
Yeah, I mean, I think that makes sense because if Tennessee is willing to play in your hands like that, because the thing with Tennessee is they run the ball a lot, obviously, because they have Derrick Henry, but they're the more talented team here, so they don't want the possessions limited, as you mentioned. So I think that there is logic to that. It just, you know, you're also playing with fire because Derrick Henry could go for 275 yards and three touchdowns. So, you know, there's a give and take to that that you're worried about.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's no right way to attack this Titans offense. That's why they're so good. And it doesn't help that the Colts defense has had its struggles, especially in their secondary. Let's move on. I'm going to give you...
What about Levi Griffith's comments here? Are you taking Man United or Tottenham? I don't know how this got in here.
The Levi Griffin. I'm going to go Man United.
That's a good pick. I think Ronaldo's guaranteed a goal in this one. I think he's going to get a
probably
goal.
Like three.
Yeah, we'll see what happens there. Thank you for the soccer chat. That's interesting.
Yeah, that's nice for Kyle. Kyle appreciates that. And I'll go along with it. I'm going to give you a game here. I am going to give you the only game that has a less than 3-point spread left, Cowboys at Vikings, lasting all the way to 8 here, despite it being a 1.5 spread. Where are you going here?
I'm locking the Cowboys. Like,
wow, okay.
I listen, Minnesota's a pretty good team. I think that they're better than what their record shows, but the Dallas Cowboys are one of the 5 best teams in the NFC. They're in championship contention for me. Like, if this was the Buccaneers, is this a 1.5-point spread? I don't think so. I think the Buccaneers would be favored by 6 or 7. So I think that this is a little bit, I think I'm playing with house money on this one. I think Cowboys easily win this one by 2. And as good as Minnesota, I think, is talent-wise, there's a lot of things I don't trust about this team. I think Clint Kubiak has been better as a play caller, but it's still not great. They still run the ball a little too much for me. And I just don't know if they're going to get into that kind of war with Cowboys and win. So I'm going with Cowboys. I'm locking it up.
All right. Locking up the Cowboys. You know, they only have to cover a 1.5-point spread. It would be hilarious if that was 1 by 1. That would be fantastic. I have Minnesota winning this one. I'm picking the underdog. Doesn't matter, but, you know, just in case you were curious about my pick, I think Minnesota. So I think, for one thing, both of these teams, I think, defensively have performed better than we thought they would heading into this season. I think you look at the kind of the Vikings slow, tough start. A lot of that was they played teams that I think we didn't realize were as good as they ended up being, like, you know, Arizona early on. The Vikings defense has performed better as of late. I think that this, I might trust this Vikings offense to score more points than this Cowboys offense, which I guess makes sense if I'm picking them to win. That's typically how that works. Because, you know, listen, Kirk Cousins playing at an MVP level, although Dak Prescott's playing very well as well, but you also have the, you know, I don't know. I think both these offenses are pretty similar to me. I just kind of trust, I guess the best, better way to put it is, I think I might trust this Vikings defense to stop Dallas a little bit better. Part of me worries with Dallas about, like, the, okay, I don't know if Kirk Cousins is going to throw a ball directly to Trayvon Diggs this game, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's fair. And I think that's going to be a fun game because I think both of these teams are going to be able to move the ball. But at the same time, I think, I don't know. I feel like Dallas, it's hard to pick against Dallas's offense right now. I just think that this offense is kind of a wagon. I think it's going to move the ball on anybody. And while I think this Minnesota defense is better than what we've expected, I'm not ready to say it's going to slow down Dallas enough to get stops. And I think Dallas can at least get a couple stops in this game. And that's why I'm picking them to win. I think this could be a high scoring game, but I also could see it being lower than expected, even though the offenses are good because they run the ball. But I just think Dallas is going to put up points on a lot of possessions. And I don't know if Minnesota is going to keep up.
Yeah. So some people, not as, you know, Kirk is on the same level as Dak. Just stop. Kirk is playing good, but not an MVP level. Slow to roll a little bit. For these 6 weeks, Kirk Cousins has been incredible. Kirk Cousins has been really good. Kirk Cousins has had maybe like 1 or 2 plays this entire season where I've been like, that wasn't great. I can't say the same for Dak Prescott. Kirk Cousins has absolutely been on fire this season. And, you know, I think they're pretty similar. Like, I think it's kind of dealer's choice of who would you like better right now.
Kirk Cousins is playing well, so well that us and Minnesota fans are saying, stop handing the ball to Dalvin Cook. Like,
right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's got to that point where they say, stop running the ball so much because our passing game is that good. And Dalvin Cook's a terrific player too, so don't get me wrong. But at the same time, I think the thing is I trust Kellen Moore to call a better game than Kubiak. And I think that's also leading to me because I think that Dallas just seems to have maximized this offense. On a per play basis, this offense is amazing. And I'm not sure on a per play basis, this Minnesota offense has played at its full potential because I think the play calling is just a little off. And I think it needs to be at full strength this week.
Yeah, I think that's what's giving me pause. And that's why I'm giving you this game. And it's just the coaching is, I do think, I just don't trust this Vikings coaching. I think that's really what it all comes down to me. You see, Luke Brown says Kirk less than Mahomes. I would say Kirk Cousins this year has been better than Mahomes. Although obviously we would all choose Mahomes over Kirk Cousins for, like, you know, for the next 10 years.
Or for the rest of the season, you know?
Right, yeah, or for Sunday.
Yeah.
I guess Monday.
You know, He's been good this season. He's been terrific. I've been on this. We've both been on this. He's been a really good player. And I really like this passing game. I just wish they used it more.
Yeah, I agree. Again, he won them the game in Carolina. Kirk Cousins is good. Stay woke.
Yeah. So we can move on. I think that might be the marquee game of the week, honestly. I think that's what I'm going with.
Yeah, I think that's a good one. Although there's another tomorrow night, we'll have another one. But where are you going with your next pick? Are you going there?
I am. There's two games left that I really don't have a feel for because of the uncertainty around it. And obviously, you know, this one is a lot of stuff going on with Green Bay right now with the receivers. That being said, it's like I thought about locking this, but I was just like, I don't really want to bet against Aaron Rodgers. So which side are you going with this?
Yeah. Real quick, this is the comment. These kind of stuff. Cowboys blew out the Panthers and Vikings barely beat them, though. That's not how this works. The transitive property does not always equate in football. Matchups are a thing, and I feel like the Panthers got very lucky to be in that game. Moving on. Although
didn't
I appreciate
the Chargers beat the Raiders and then the Ravens or Raiders beat the Ravens and then the Chargers got blown out by Baltimore, but the Chargers beat the Raiders, right? So
yeah, like, you know, the Jets beat the Titans this year. The weird stuff happens. Back to Packers Cardinals. This should be a very fun game. Although it sucks that Devontae Adams can't play. It sucks about all these injuries. I know J.J. Watt is down now as well. I believe it's one of the receivers. I want to say Alan Lazard is also not going to be able to play. So
Lazard and Adams are out. Yeah.
Yeah. So that just sucks. And I think like this could have been a real chance for Green Bay and it could have been a real test. But I feel like you lose Devontae Adams. Like that's a big piece of this team. Kind of. The question mark about this Packers receiving core has never been they don't have a high-end talent. It's been their depth. Well, they lose that high-end talent. Now it's like, how are you going to scheme stuff open, especially against a secondary? It's been pretty good, surprisingly, with Arizona. And the flip side is I don't see how Green Bay stops Arizona because I don't know if anyone can stop Arizona on offense. So I have the Cardinals here and, you know, I think I have them to cover as well, the 6.5-point spread.
Are you locking or no?
Not locking.
Not locking. Okay. I would probably pick Arizona. But like I said, I don't like picking against Aaron Rodgers. That always just, you know, frightens me. Unless there's like an equally great quarterback, which Murray is a great quarterback. I don't know if he's Aaron Rodgers yet, though. I guess here's the thing. So one of the things I think that makes Brady and Rodgers so great, and some of the things that I think go underrated with these two, is they understand the circumstance and how to maximize their offense. I think better than any two quarterbacks I've ever seen, these two specifically. And I almost feel like this is a game where the Packers can throw everybody for a loop and just turn this into like a Aaron Jones, AJ Dillon kind of run fest. And he's just audibling at a bunch of pass situations. Like, I could see them honestly spreading the field out and then giving Aaron Jones 25 carries out of like a spread out offense. And just trying to, you know, up until like the last week, Arizona's run defense hasn't been great at times. So, and then just trying to say, hey, we're going to wear you down. We're going to control the clock. We're outmanned right now, especially with our best receiver being out, best two receivers being out. Let's try and slow this game down and make it a little bit ugly. And we have two good running backs in our backfield to be able to do that. Now, is that could be probably the roadmap to the Packers winning this game, right?
Yeah, I could see it. And again, this is definitely within range. While I do think that I would give I like the Cardinals and I feel good about the Cardinals, I would say this is within, like, the Packers could easily steal this one. Like, they could make that happen. They get the right game plan and they could win this one. One thing you got to do is, again, don't blitz Kyler Murray. He's a guy you can't blitz. Never do that. Just let play coverage against him. One interesting thing about Murray is he's been so good when under pressure this season that typically falls off a little bit. Like last year, Herbert was amazing under pressure. It's fallen off. Basically, everyone that has like a passer rating above 100 under pressure ends up like eventually reverting back to like 70 to 55, somewhere in that range. So you expect that to go down a little bit. Maybe there has been a bit of a luck factor for Arizona so far, which I think is fair, but they're also still really good. And I think Arizona is the better team.
Yeah. How do you feel I guess let's here's the matchup I'm interested in watching.
Okay.
This is it looks like a mismatch. I'm interested to see how, you know, we've both been high on him this season as a rookie. Eric Stokes against DeAndre Hopkins.
You know? Yeah, I mean, I feel horrible about it. I think that's terrible. Yeah, I think DeAndre Hopkins is a monster.
Yeah, I mean, I think it lends itself to being a matchup problem. But what if Eric Stokes is able to make a couple plays in this game? Then all of a sudden, you know, it doesn't look as awful as it does. And all of a sudden, the Green Bay Packers are creating a couple turnovers and have a chance to win this game.
Well, that's how you win, right? Is that you get Kyler Murray to do a couple of those jump balls and you win on one or two of them. Like, that's how, like, you know, Eric Stokes I was a big fan of him out of college. There were some flaws. One of those flaws is not his ball skills. He seemingly was always in the right place to get an interception. You know, he gets one of those. That could completely change the course of this game. But also worth mentioning, you still have the Jair Alexander injury, and with all of these options for Arizona, you know, you have, it's not just DeAndre Hopkins. AJ Green's like weirdly like returned to form and been a good wide receiver for them. Mm-hmm. Christian Kirk, Rondell Moore. So you have four legit guys. I just don't know if Green Bay can stop all those guys. You're going to need to win a turnover battle, probably.
I think I agree. It'll be a good game, but right now with the guys being out, it's just hard to pick the Packers in this game. But I do think there is a roadmap for them to win, and part of that is having maybe one of the best quarterback in football.
Do you go a little bit underdog mode here for Green Bay, which means, you know, go for it on more fourth downs, like try to make the game come down to as few plays as possible, basically?
I would. Because they are the underdogs. I mean, this 6.5-point spread, I don't think is fraudulent. Arizona is a very good team. Are they the favorites to win the Super Bowl right now? Because they probably should be at this point with the way the team's played.
I don't know.
And, you know, they're a better team, and you're shorthanded. So I think you should try and play underdog mode.
Yeah, I think so as well. I think that this is ego. Just don't have the ego about it. Just say, hey, it's because we're injured. We wouldn't play this way if we were fully healthy.
Yeah. It'll be a fun game still, I think. But yeah, I think the problem is that they're just too undermanned right now.
Yeah. And also, an all-time great uniform matchup, Packers at Cardinals. Very aesthetically pleasing. There's obviously multiple awesome games with them. There was the Rodgers Hail Mary game where he threw two Hail Marys to send it to overtime. There was the ridiculously high-scoring Aaron Rodgers versus Kurt Warner game. So always fun when these two teams play each other.
Interesting. I'm not as high on the Arizona uniform.
Well, I think it works well with Green Bay.
That's fair. I just think the white helmet's really ugly. But
okay, all right.
I'm going to get people in the chat now yelling at me.
Well, I think specifically home Cardinals uniforms with away Packers uniforms. I think that's what really works.
Home Cardinals uniforms. Yeah, I guess that's fair. Yeah, that's fair. I'll go with
okay. All right. Well, our next podcast tomorrow, we'll be just talking about ranking the uniform matchups for next week.
I can't wait. So
yeah, that should be fun. All right. I'm going to give you a game here. All right. I'm coming out like a bandit here because I'm not only not giving you, I'm not having to pick your team or my team. I'm giving you Bucks at Saints. So I think we all know I think we all feel the Buccaneers are the better team, but the Saints have historically given Bruce Arians trouble. Where are you going?
Bucks. I still believe in the Bucks. The Brady to Mike Evans connection has become maybe the best in football. You know, crazy to say, they already have like 21 touchdowns over the two, you know, not even two seasons. I think they're electric. Gronk might be back this week. I think that they have things going for them. And sure, New Orleans' defense might make a few plays, but based on what I saw this last week against what I don't think is a very good Seattle defense, I just don't know if they're going to have enough juice offensively to keep up with Tampa Bay, even in a bad offensive performance. I think Tampa Bay is one of those teams right now where they're probably coming off the bus and scoring 35, even though NFL players don't really come off of buses like college, so it's a weird expression to say. But, you know, they're coming out of the locker room and dropping 25, even on a bad game, and I just don't know if New Orleans can hit 25 on this team.
Interesting, because I think that the flip side is, like, Tampa Bay has no corners, which is, okay, here we go. Zachary Stewart, Brady has been an average game manager at best, only completing 40% of his passes beyond the line of scrimmage. He also has the best starting field position out of any quarterback, and it's not close. Okay, well, listen, you're entitled to your opinion. I completely disagree. I will say he's had an up and down season, but the ups have been very high ups. Like the Dallas game, he was incredible at. You know, he's had a couple misses. The Patriots game wasn't great. I didn't think he was fantastic in the Bears game, but you know, I think calling him an average game manager at best is a bit harsh, Kyle.
I mean, I agree.
Anyway. Of course, we're gonna say that though. I mean, we're Bucks and Patriots fan.
Thank you for the super chat. I appreciate it.
I like that. Again, really going into the Lions then, doing a super chat to criticize my current quarterback and your probably favorite quarterback ever.
Favorite football player ever? Yeah, no kidding. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, so back to the game. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, I just... What was your point again? I lost my train of thought after that.
Yeah, I did as well. But I think the Saints have a real chance in this. I mean, I think that, you know, the Saints don't have really receivers, but the Bucs don't have corners. So, like, we're both, it's basically replacement level receivers versus replacement level corners, unless Michael Thomas comes back. There's been rumors Michael Thomas might be back this week. If he is, that's a huge deal because Tampa Bay cannot cover. I mean, you know, especially with Carlton Davis out, he's done a good job in the past at times of covering Michael Thomas. Although, of course, Thomas is always going to get his matchup. I feel like Michael Thomas has been forgotten about. Like, Michael Thomas, when healthy, is an elite receiver. The guy had 1,700 yards in a season.
Yeah, no, I agree. This is definitely more of a Michael Thomas is good podcast, but yeah, I mean, he needs to be on the field is the first thing. So yeah, I mean, I don't think it's a 0% chance the Saints win, but yeah, I mean, I still just right now, whether Michael Thomas plays or not, just say like, well, on the other side, can the Saints stop the Bucs consistently? And I don't know if I can see it right now is the problem. So I know the defense kind of lends itself to slowing down Bruce Arians, and it has in the past, but I still just believe that Tampa's talent's going to win this game out.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, again, the Saints defense has given it, even in the playoff game where Tampa Bay won, it wasn't their offense that won them the game. It was their defense. And, you know, I think the flip side is, you know, we talk about usually the cover corner that gives Kamara trouble is Levant, you know, or gives halfbacks trouble is Lavonte David, who's out. And that's another big aspect. However, Devin White has kind of been the Kamara killer, mostly due to, you know, you don't have many linebackers who can just keep up with Kamara speed-wise. So that's kind of another advantage for Tampa Bay. But again, the matchup gives us trouble. And I mean, let's be honest, this is kind of the Saints Super Bowl a little bit. In the Superdome, playing the team that got you last year and ended Drew Brees' career, Saints fans got to really, you know, the Saints have got to really want this one.
Yeah, I'd say I agree. I think it's going to be closer than people think, but yeah, I don't know. I just keep going back to, well, one team has Antonio Brown, Mike Evans, and Chris Godwin and Gronk. And it's just like, well, I think that team's going to win 9 times out of 10.
I think so as well. But, you know, the Saints are like intentionally playing like Kevin White. What's going on here in New Orleans?
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing too, is like, there was a lot of Marquez Callaway hype in the offseason. And I mean, it just hasn't been there. They don't have anybody outside, right?
Like, yeah, and this was like intentional. Like, they probably thought they would have at least had some Michael Thomas. Like, they knew the injury was a thing. Like, they went into the season saying like, oh, we don't need wide receivers. Like, it's kind of a weird decision that they made.
It's a bold strategy, Cotton. We'll see if it pays off for them here.
Exactly. Let's move on. Why don't you give me a game here?
I'm not going to give you that game because I don't want to pick. Giants at Chiefs.
All right, Giants at Chiefs going this early, or given the, I think we would have thought at least a couple weeks ago this would have been the last game picked. Yeah, I mean, I'm going with the Chiefs here. They're still 10-point favorites even after all of this. I have a hot take, Kyle. I think the Chiefs are still like pretty good. I think they're a playoff team.
Yeah, I think so, but we keep saying this and they keep losing games. So when does it become the point where we're concerned?
I don't know. I mean, I think I would have to see. Well, okay, it's like there are real issues with this Chiefs team. Their defense actually played all right last week. You know, it played all right for a couple of weeks, and then their offense fell apart. I keep going back to, there's no way this team is going to continuously turn the ball over 3 or 4 times throughout the season. Like, that just that can't seemingly happen. I know that they're probably going to turn the ball over more than an average team, but, you know, like, I just keep going back to there has to be some regression in these turnovers at a certain point for Kansas City. I even consider locking this up. Don't think I'll do that, you know, I think this is a Kansas City thing. You know, Luke Brown, Chiefs bad. That's all I have to say. I mean, I guess maybe I should really make my point. I think Mahomes is still good. I think Mahomes is still really good, and he's like had a couple of bad weeks, and he hasn't lived up to the hype this season. I'm still on the Mahomes trade more than the Chiefs train.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about this on Sunday. Mahomes is still good, but the Chiefs probably are bad. So, or, you know, the rest of the Chiefs roster isn't very good. And so here's the thing I'm interested in. Partial practice participants Wednesday, Saquon Barkley, Kenny Golladay, Kadarius Toney. Now, I don't know, like, you're still saying the Chiefs are the favorite, who cares? But at the same time, I feel like Kadarius Toney is kind of built to destroy the Chiefs right now. And I think he's been electric when he's on the field. Obviously, when he's not punching dudes or injured, that's right. You know, it's few and far between so far. But I think he's been electric when he's on the field. And I think if he's on the field, I think the Giants can move the ball, because I think Toney is that kind of player. I think Saquon, if he's healthy, can also make some plays. So, yeah, I mean, I think that that would lead itself to the Giants moving the football and making this game interesting. This offense hasn't been, like, horrible all the time. I think that they'll be able to make this game interesting, at least if they have those guys on the field.
Do we see – so the Chiefs got embarrassed, and sometimes that's a good thing in football. Get embarrassed, kind of realize, okay, we can't just keep doing everything the same way. We have to start mixing stuff up. Is this the game where Kansas City says, okay, let's start throwing more checkdowns. Let's start – playing a little bit more boring, and people keep blaming Mahomes, but like the game plan is designed to push the ball down the field. Do we see a different game plan in this one?
Yeah, that's the thing. Could this team just finally be in FU mode? And there's a possibility for that. So yeah, I mean, I think that they have to. I think they need to kind of wake up and say, hey, we can't just do all the fun stuff, all the fun plays all the time. Like, we have to have we have to have some boring plays into our game plan, because it opens up the fun plays, you know, and that's kind of a dumb way to explain football. But at the same time, like, I also think it's partially true. Like, this team has to be like content with a 3-yard carry every now and then. And it just seems like they're not. They want to have like a 50-yard pass play every play. And football is just not operated that way. Madden's operated that way, but football isn't really operated that way.
Yeah, yeah, I think I do agree. The flip side, though, like, the Giants aren't good. Like, that's the other thing. It's like maybe the Chiefs aren't good, but like, they're still better than the Giants.
I agree. Yeah, I mean,
sounds like you kind of don't agree.
No, I agree. I do.
Half-hearted agree.
I agree. The thing, I don't know. Like, I think I'm at the point now where I want to see it from the Chiefs. I want to see them come out and kind of play the right way. I want to see them do the right things. And we just haven't really seen it with this team right now.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, listen, last week was tough. That was a really, I mean, and they've had a few of those at this point. But again, the Chiefs still, like, it's not like they're losing to bad teams here. I don't know. I'm not willing to give up on Kansas City yet.
They're still probably a playoff team or in the contention. But like I said, I think that there's some significant problems with this team right now, the way they're playing.
I mean, we're all going crazy about how good the Ravens are. The Chiefs, the Ravens played that same scheme, and the Chiefs should have won that game. There was a fumble in field goal range. It should have let them win that game. Like, that's kind of like they win that one, and people feel very differently about Kansas City. Everyone talked about how, oh, well, the Chiefs didn't look that great for a couple of weeks in a row. They beat Washington 31-13. Like the Chiefs, like, I think people are, I think there's a bit of selective thinking with Kansas City right here. I mean, you know, their four losses, Cleveland, the Chargers, the Bills, and the Titans. Those are four good teams. I know.
But those are all teams that they're probably going to have to beat to win a Super Bowl.
But so here's my thing is, like, I think there's actual schematic changes that they can do to make their team better. Like, that's my thing is, I think that there's actual, like, things they're doing wrong that they can make better. Whereas other teams, it's like, okay, well, you're already doing the right thing and you're just not winning.
How do you think this defense gets better? Let's start with that.
Well, let's start with putting Chris Jones at defensive tackle and, like, having him stay there. Like, they were moving him around a lot last. No, he's defensive tackle. Like, listen, it was a good idea. It was worth a shot. It didn't work out. defensive tackle Chris Jones. Also, I think they got a mix up who's playing at linebacker. I thought that the Juan Thornhill decision was smart, and that has made him look a little better. So, I mean, again, you know, the past, since they benched Daniel Sorensen, they gave up 13 to Washington and like 27 to Tennessee. Like, they weren't terrible against the Titans. They weren't great, but like, it's the Titans.
Yeah, I think that's fair. But I mean, we'll see what happens in this game. I mean, I fully expect the Chiefs to win it. I just think that, you know, I want to see them do things the right way for once this season before I say this team's all of a sudden back.
Here's how I feel. I think it's reasonable to be skeptical. I'm skeptical. I'm not willing to say the Chiefs are going to be as good as they are last year. I mean, I think it'd be impossible to. They already have four losses. They only lost, you know, Mahomes lost once last year, twice if you count the Super Bowl. So, like, they're clearly not as good as they were last year. I think being skepticism is fine. I don't think that jumping to conclusions and saying that, like, Mahomes was never actually good and he was just lucky his first few years, and saying that the Chiefs are never going to go to the Super Bowl again, and, you know, all this stuff. I think people are getting a bit too I've been through this too many times with the New England Patriots after they go, like, you know, 2-3 and everyone's like they're done, and then they don't lose the rest of the season.
That's fair. I think you just brought up the Patriots to get me to agree with you, but
we've done this for a while, Kyle. I know how this works.
Yeah. So I'm concerned about certain parts of their team. Patrick Mahomes is not one of those parts of the team, is the thing. So I think that's going away from the narrative a little bit, that this is a problem with, you know, him. It was one bad game. Now, granted, we haven't seen a lot of bad games out of his, you know, career. Mm. And that's probably the aspect that was so surprising.
Yeah, that's fair. You know, I also think about Aaron Rodgers, who had a very similar thing. He had a great start to his career, had a bit of a down season, but then still made the playoffs that year. So we'll see. Chiefs definitely not as scary, though, as they have been in years past. Let's move on. We've got four games left to talk about. I'm going to give you a game. I'm going to give you Rams at Texans, the 14.5 point spread. Where are you going here?
Obviously, I'm taking the Rams, and I'm taking the Rams by a lot. But
you're taking them if you had to pick by the spread, where would you go?
Probably Rams 14.5.
Okay.
I mean, this Texans team has been blown out the last 2 weeks, and that 31-5 game was kind of horrible. So yeah, I mean, I think they win this game by a lot. The Texans can't throw the ball. I mean, they can't run the ball. They just traded Mark Ingram, which, you know, isn't much, but at the same time, he was a player on the Texans roster. So, yeah, I mean, I think right now I would just say the Rams are going to win this game by a lot. I don't really know how Texans move the ball at all.
Yeah, I think that there's a chance for Houston. I think, for one thing, if Tyrod Taylor is back, that's going to be the that's the sort of a bit of a wild card here. So that's kind of one of the reasons why I'm giving that to you. So that's a factor. I also think it's like, you know, the Rams have had a couple of, like, weird moments with them. Like, they've had some great games as well, but they did, you know, there was the Lions game, which was a bit weird for them. They did get crushed by the Cardinals. Like, they've had a couple of missteps, although for the most part, they have been very good, and that part of that is just football. I think I like the Rams to win, obviously. It'd be insane to say the other thing. I think they're going to score a billion points, but I could see Houston maybe doing something if Tyrod Taylor is there and potentially covering. So I think I'll give Houston the cover here. How about that?
That'll be interesting. Yeah, I think that's fair. But at the same time, I feel like this is just the kind of defense and secondary that Matt Stafford could go for 400 on.
Although I have to say, maybe a hot take, Matt Stafford has been good this season. Matt Stafford has not been outstanding this season.
He had a good couple first games. It's kind of slowed down a little bit. I still think that there's a propensity for him to go nuts, though, in this one.
Yeah, I mean, it's still, like, it's worth the trade. Like, I think the trade was great. Like, you're a better team now with Stafford than you were with Goff. But, yeah, that's how I feel about it. He's been very good. Let's move on. Why don't you give me a game here?
Now I know what game you're locking up. And I'm going to make you wait one more for it. Okay. I'm going to go. Actually, no, I'm not. I'm just going to give you Steelers at Browns. You're locking up the Browns, right?
Yes, I am locking up the Browns. That is why this fell so far, because I was waiting to lock it up. Kyle, I think maybe a mistake giving it to me now. You could have had your choice of the other two, although given that the other two are Dolphins at Bills and Bengals at Jets, probably doesn't matter. Yeah, I'm locking up the Cleveland Browns minus three here. I know that there's it seems like Baker's probably going to be back, which I think helps, especially if he's healthy. I keep betting against the Steelers, and I've gotten burned a couple of times, but I'm going to bet against them here. I don't think the Steelers are very good. I think the Browns are good. I don't see how the Steelers move the ball in this game, like, ever. I don't know if they get a yard here. The flip side is I think Cleveland gets more than a yard. I have Cleveland even with the 3-point spread.
Yeah, I mean, I think Cleveland's a better team. I guess the thing is like, Ben Roethlisberger, but at the same time, this Cleveland Browns secondary has weirdly had like weird games where like guys are just open all the time, and like we've seen Steelers kind of hit like a couple big plays with Deontay Johnson and like Claypool get stuff going. Like, could this be a kind of game where the Cleveland secondary kind of gets beat up a little bit?
Yeah. If super chat, do Bengals at New York bye weeks next? We'll see if Kyle takes that into, or I guess we'll see if I take that into consideration when I make my pick. Spoiler alert, I will. Don't worry. That's what we're gonna do. I don't know. Okay, that happened at the Arizona game, I guess. But part of that is just like Cliff Kingsbury is really good. Like this, or I don't even think it was Kingsbury, but this Cardinals offensive coaching staff does that to everybody so far this season. Other than that, like they shut down Denver. You could say it's Denver, sure, but they shut them down. The Chargers is the other game, but even that, again, it's the Chargers, and I think that the 47 points is a bit misleading. Other than that, I mean, you know, gave up 7 against Minnesota. They gave up 6 against Chicago. Again, I guess you could argue the Chiefs game. So now that I'm seeing it, I kind of see your point a little bit. There have been some instances. But to me, it's like, okay, it's been against good teams that they've done that. I don't think the Steelers are that.
Yeah, I think that's fair. So the Browns should beat them up. I think this is a good lock. Nick Chubb might be back. Jack Conklin might be back. And Baker might be back. So I think you're getting a good advantage here. Although rivalry game could be a little weird, but I think this is a good pick.
Yeah, I agree. I think this is something that I expect Cleveland to win. And if Cleveland loses, well, then like, how do we feel about Cleveland? Not that great. I think Cleveland pulled this one off, especially after, you know, they got a longer week as well with the extra few days. So we'll see what happens. Want to move on?
Yeah, we can move on from this one.
All right. So I give you a game. I'm going to give you Bengals at Jets, or as someone in the chat called it, the bye weeks. Who do you think is winning this one, Kyle?
I almost locked this up. The Bengals are going to blow them out. Bengals are good. This defense is good. And I'm not trusting some dude named Mike White, who apparently plays quarterback. So, yeah. Listen, I watch college football. No idea who Mike White is. I don't know anything about the guy. I found out last week that he's a quarterback. I found out last week that he's on the Jets. And, I mean, it's not going to be good. They don't have receivers. They have a guy named Mike White. I don't know. Like, this is they should just volunteer the quarterback position at this point. If this guy's playing quarterback, I don't know. I don't think it's going to go very well no matter who's back there with this Bengals defense. But, yeah, so Bengals.
Could we see a Joe Flacco in relief performance potentially if it gets too bad?
I mean, potentially. That'd be kind of hard to just come in. But I mean, if Joe Flacco's playing, then it should be Jets money lines the bet.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Also, it's completely hilarious that, Jets, obviously their star quarterback, Zach Wilson, gets hurt. That part's not hilarious. But then the Jets are like, oh, we should get a backup quarterback. Like, what were you guys? Did you guys not realize this was a possible thing that could happen? Like, I've heard it described with Mike White as, it's like in Madden when like your quarterback goes down and that's just the guy who's in. It's like, oh, Mike White. Like that's just exactly like how that works.
Yeah. I don't know, man. Like, yeah, I think this is going to be a brutal game. This is going to be a bloodbath, I feel like, honestly, though. Like, yeah, what is the Jets' roadmap for stopping this team? There's nothing, right?
Yeah, I can't think of a single thing. I literally don't, like, usually you can at least, like, talk yourself into, like, the Texans. Like, okay, maybe if they run a similar scheme to how, you know, we saw the Cardinals have success against the Rams, maybe you just throw your way into a victory. It's like here on one side, I don't think the Jets, they're another team. It's like, if they get over 100 total yards in this game, I'm chalking it up to a win for them. I think this is a nightmare scenario against a pretty good defense. The flip side is like, who's covering Ja'Marr Chase? Like, who for this Jets secondary? Yeah, I mean, I guess so. I mean, this Jets secondary hasn't. I think the Jets defense is vastly overrated. I've been saying this for a while. Jets defense is not good. Doesn't help when this offense is putrid, and that doesn't help when your star quarterback, who at least like has made some plays in one game, like at least you have that going for it. You know, he's now hurt. Jets least watchable team in football right now.
Yeah, I think so. There's nothing really to look forward to this team when Wilson's not in there. Man, I'm talking myself more and more into it. I wish I could change my lock. That's too bad. But, yeah, the Bengals win this game by a billion. So, okay.
How do you like this take? Mike White will have a week to prepare. People are seriously underestimating him. He was a monster in college and just hasn't had many opportunities in the NFL. Is your hope, if you're a Jets fan, that Mike White does so bad so that makes you feel better about Zach Wilson?
Yeah, I'm convinced now with this guy's name being M that's Mike White actually. So
that's Mike White's burner.
Yeah, that's Mike White's burner there that's saying mm-hmm. that he's going to light it up. I mean, I think, I don't know. That's kind of weird to say, hey, I hope he sucks because then you can justify Zach Wilson.
But I've done this. I remember when we had, as a Buccaneers fan, when they kept going back and forth with Jameis Winston and Ryan Fitzpatrick, there was times when I was like, okay, I want Ryan Fitzpatrick to suck. So that way, like, we'll see more Jameis Winston because he's younger and hopefully he can be good. Like, we know what Fitzpatrick is. In hindsight, we should have just gone to Fitzpatrick. That was dumb.
Yeah. I guess he did have some pretty good years after transferring from USF, ending up on the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers, you know. He had some years, but, you know. Think the NFL is going to be a little different than the Conference USA. So, you know, just a hunch.
Yeah. Could we potentially get a Nathan Peterman-esque game from Mike White? Who, by the way, I know nothing about, might actually be decent. Neither of us know anything. But that's the funny thing is
this guy actually has a good game.
Yeah, that's like, and like, he wasn't horrible when he played. He threw a couple picks, but, you know, he had the interception that was kind of set up for him, right? I mean, it wasn't like a complete mess given the situation.
Yeah, I guess that's fair. So, well, I mean, we'll see what happens with this one. I'm just not trusting Mike White's going to do anything here. And Bengals defense, I think, is actually pretty decent. So,
yeah, because there's a time when I was like, oh man, will the Steelers Browns get to me? Not realizing that I picked second. So, yes, it will get to me. But there was a part where I was like, if that doesn't happen, I would lock up this one because this is definitely a lockable 9.5-point spread. Final game. This is the one that's going to me, the Dolphins, also known as the Mammals, at the Bills. I am picking the Buffalo Bills to beat the stupid Dolphins that are just, what's going on with the Miami Dolphins so far? I think that obviously this is an easy pick, and that's why it's the last one picked.
Yeah, I mean, this team stinks. They're not a good football team. Right. Yeah, I mean, there's really nothing else to say besides that. I guess we can end the show now. I mean, honestly, though, like, we just saw this a couple weeks ago without Tua. Or Tua got hurt in this game, wasn't it? Or was this his first game out?
I'm trying to remember. Here, let me double check. It was, so yeah, this was the game where he got hurt after just throwing four passes. So maybe that's the hope is, hey, you get Tua back in there. And Josh Allen has had some struggles against Miami. Like, he didn't look great against Miami. Granted, they still won 35-0, but that was more about Miami. It's really their offensive ineptitude and some touchdowns late, especially, you know, they had three rushing touchdowns in that game, weirdly. So that's the hope for Miami, is that you can make stuff happen. I think I could see this game being closer maybe than people realize, but closer than people realize might be, you know, Buffalo winning by, you know, 13.
28-7. So
yeah, exactly.
What side would you bet this?
I think I would bet I'll bet on the Mammals. I'll say Mammals cover 13.5. How about that?
If that happens, you're not a fan. I'll give you an additional point off. How's that?
No, you don't have to do that. We don't have to ruin the sanctity of the game. You're that convinced they'll cover.
Yeah, I mean, Buffalo, I still think Buffalo's the best team in the AFC. And I think the Mammals might be the worst team in the AFC. After the losing to the Jaguars, I think they have that title right now. So yeah, I think they win by a lot.
Yeah, not a horrible take. I mean, listen, Buffalo has blown the brakes off of every bad team they played, except for the Steelers, who they lost to. Still one of the weirder games of the season.
Yeah, that's definitely the anomaly of the season, right? Mm-hmm. Besides the Jets and Titans.
Yeah, I think Jets Titans probably number one, but that one's certainly up there. I guess one last thing, you know, this Tua stuff, like, I guess as a Dolphins fan, I mean, your hope is that you see stuff from Tua, right? That's what you're rooting for the rest of the season.
He's had moments that I thought he's been pretty good. The problem is he ends those moments with a really stupid interception.
Right.
But I also think he's had moments that, you know, he looks like a pretty good quarterback. He's got pretty good timing. He's one of the better slant throwers, I think, in the NFL right now, actually. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, he's a pretty accurate passer. He just has really bad interceptions mixed into it that he definitely needs to cut out of his game. And it's surprising because, you know, it's not like the Jameis thing where you saw that in college. You didn't really see that in college with Tua, but it's now showing itself in the NFL. So I think it gets cleaned up a little bit. But hopefully he, you know, improves all that.
I think the short range passes he's so good at because teams aren't used to seeing a lefty throw. So they're like, they don't see the ball coming out right away. That's my theory.
Huh. Yeah, I don't know about that one. yeah. I mean, there's another lefty who I think is going to be pretty good in the NFL next year, too.
Tebow?
No.
Okay.
Get out of Virginia. So.
All right. Well, all right. Well,
lefty quarterbacks, they're back.
Lefty quarterbacks, maybe not back. We'll see though. Should be interesting. You know, someone threw out on Twitter, like, what if Tua, you know, there's been the Tua trade rumors, of course. What if Tua got traded to the Saints? That would be an interesting. I think I could like that fit. You know, they've shown that they can have success with a quarterback without the biggest arm in the later years of Drew Brees' career.
Yeah, I mean, with all this Deshaun Watson rumors, I also saw a three-way trade that involved him going to Washington.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a few different things that I think, I don't know. I think they just got to hope that he pans out. You know, I think it's that simple.
Yeah. Zachary Stewart says, if Bills lose, I'll buy a Tim Tebow jersey. All right. I wonder which Tim Tebow jersey he means. My guess would be Patriots.
That'd be the coolest one. I mean, who wants a Jets jersey? All right, I guess it probably has to be the Broncos, right?
I think so. I think maybe a Jaguars jersey. Well, would that be weirder or less weird? I almost feel like more people know that he went to the Jaguars than the Patriots.
I would say so.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, there you go.
Get a Gators jersey.
Yeah, exactly. That one would actually like work. All right. That's our show. Thank you to everyone for watching live or watching after the fact or listening after the fact, whatever it is you do. Kyle, let them know where they can find us on Twitter.
Yeah, make sure to follow us on Twitter. That's at Jackson Kruger. Make sure to follow me at by Kyle Grondin. And then make sure to follow the account page at On the Sideline JK. That's at On the Sideline JK on Twitter.
Yeah, Kyle, are you watching the baseball at all?
I glanced at it, but I've been in a lot of basketball mode lately, so it's been hard to keep. There's too many sports right now. We need to slow it down. I had race weekend last week, and I was really into that. And at the race, obviously, I had basketball going on, and you know. It's like the World Series could not be put at a worse time.
Yeah, it's a little tough. Yeah, America's team, Houston Astros, currently up 6-2. So there you go.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're going to win the series. I know they lost game one, but I mean, they're just way more talented. I feel like they're just going to wait out like until Houston or Atlanta stops getting hot, basically.
Yeah, I think so as well. But we'll see. Maybe we'll talk about that a little bit more. We'll when the series concludes, we'll talk about it and do a segment on it. But yeah, again, thanks to everyone. We do appreciate it. Kyle, any final thoughts before we head out?
I think this will be a better week than last week. We had some ugly games last week. I think we'll get some competitive ones. The lines are definitely a lot closer. So
yeah. Also, just so everyone knows, TJ Levy was here in the chat. Just forgot to comment.
Well, you might as well have not been here then, man.
No.
Thank you for tuning in.
No, we appreciate it. All of the non-commenters as well. Yes. All right. Thanks to everyone. We do appreciate it. Until next time, have a good one.
Peace.